After simple harmonic motion, now we have to study circular motion. So circular motion is nothing but just a part of simple harmonic motion, a type of simple harmonic motion. Okay. So we know simple harmonic motion is the periodic motion. Okay. Harmonic means periodic. So periodic functions are there. Sine curves, sine and cos both are periodic functions. So periodic functions are used to define the simple harmonic motion, and circular motion is a kind of simple harmonic motion. That's why it is also represented using sine and cos curves. Okay. So circular motion happens when two perpendicular forces, means two perpendicular simple harmonic forces, okay, means the forces that cause simple harmonic motion. So since circular motion happens when two perpendicular simple harmonic forces act on a particle, okay, and these two simple harmonic forces have a phase difference of pi by 2, okay, means 90 degree. So these simple harmonic forces have a phase difference of 90 degree with respect to each other. So if you represent F1 as F0 into sine omega t, okay, because magnitude should be the same, the amplitude should be the same. Okay, so you can see here that both have the same amplitude F0. Okay, so amplitude is same for the circular motion. So circular motion is happening by the application of two perpendicular simple harmonic forces which have a phase difference of pi by 2, that is 90 degree. So if you represent F1 by F0 into sine omega t, so F0 is the amplitude of F1. Now this F1 produces displacement x1 is equal to x0 into sine omega t. Okay, so x1 is the displacement caused by F1. Both are the external forces. Both F1 and F2 are external forces. Now F1 is equal to F0 into cos omega t, because sine omega t plus 90 degree will give you cos omega t. Okay. And the displacement caused by F2 is x2. Okay. So x2 is equal to x0 into cos omega t. So both means all the terms that you can see, the forces have the same amplitude and the displacement have the same magnitude. Okay. Both are x0 and x0 respectively, and F0 respectively. Okay. The only difference is the phase. Okay. So you can see here, this is F1. Okay. This is the sine curve. Okay, the sine curve starts from zero, means passes through zero, not a starts, passes through zero. So this passes through zero. Now this is, now this F2 has a type of cosine function. Okay, so cosine function starts like this, that at zero, it has a value of highest value. At zero, it will have the highest magnitude. X0 will give, okay. Whereas sine curve will give zero amplitude at zero theta value. Okay. So these are the two forces, F1 and F2. Or you can also represent displacement using this, that this amplitude will be X0 and X0 respectively. Okay, so you can also represent displacement using the same, because displacement is also sine and cosine curves respectively. So this can be represented by these two curves also. Okay, moving on. Now this is the axis for F or X0, means forces or displacement, and this is the time. Okay, so this is means the y-axis is for F or X, and this x-axis is for the time. Okay, so this is the thing that is happening. Now we will see circular motion in complete. Okay, first we understood that how this circular motion came into picture. Okay, now we will study circular motion in detail. So circular motion. So in circular motion, the path or the curve of motion is a circle. okay, means the curve traced by the particle will be a circle. The path followed by the particle will be a circle. Okay, the curve made by the particle during its motion will be a circle, will be a circular part. Okay, means the circular curve or circular arc, anything like that. Okay, so this is the circular motion. So in the circular motion, the path or the curve of motion is a circle. Okay. Now this is the figure that has been drawn. Okay, so the particle is executing a circular motion in which the angular velocity is omega. Okay, now this angular velocity is anti-clockwise, so this is a positive one. Okay, the theta will also be a positive one because we are taking anti-clock as the positive one. Okay, so the angular velocity omega is the positive one. The theta, that is, which is the angular displacement, theta. Okay, so theta is also a positive one. This d theta is also a positive one. Okay, so this is the initial position of the particle represented by Pxy. Okay, so this is the point P and it has a coordinates x into x and y, okay, respectively. Now the particle has moved to this point P dash, which is represented by x dash and y dash respectively. Okay, now this is the origin O, or the center, because this is also known as center. This is the center of this circle, so O is the center of the circle. Now you know these are the synonyms. Okay, these are the synonyms for the center, so you can also call it origin. You can also call it mean position, and you can also call it equilibrium position, because at this position the net force on the particle is equal to zero. Okay, here we will have zero acceleration. Okay, at the center you will not have any acceleration. The acceleration, the net acceleration will be equal to zero. The net force acting on the particle will be equal to zero when it has reached the center. Okay, so center is known as origin, or the mean position, or the equilibrium position. Equilibrium, why? Because the net force acting at the point is equal to zero. The net acceleration acting at the particle at this point at the center is equal to zero. Okay, now in this figure, theta represents angular position or displacement. Okay, so the particle started from here and moved to point P. Okay, so this is the angular position. Now the angular velocity, which will be the instantaneous one. Why instantaneous? Because delta t is tending to zero. Okay, means the change of time or the duration of time is tending to zero, means at that instant. Okay, so instantaneous angular velocity is equal to limit delta t tending to zero is equal to delta theta by delta t. So delta theta is the angular distance. Okay, and delta t is the time duration, okay, which has been passed, elapsed for covering this delta theta distance. Okay, this is the angular distance. Now this is the instantaneous one and the limit is tending to zero, so this is converted to d theta by dt. Okay, means differentiation of theta with respect to time. So omega is equal to d theta by dt. Now theta changes position from theta to theta plus delta theta in time delta t. Okay, so delta theta by delta t and delta t tending to zero will give d theta by dt, and this will give you instantaneous angular velocity. Now the angular acceleration, So angular acceleration is nothing but the change of rate of change of miss angular acceleration is nothing but the rate of change of angular velocity. Okay, so alpha is equal to d omega by dt. Okay, means change of angular velocity with respect to time. Okay, now you can see the position, means the directions. Okay, so the linear velocity or the tangential velocity is represented by v. Okay, the linear velocity or the tangential velocity of the particle is represented by v. Now this v is acting tangentially. Okay, this v is acting tangentially. Now this is the direction of v, and this is also the direction of tangential acceleration. Okay, the tangential acceleration is also acting in this direction only. Now you know this will be the direction of r. Okay, so this is the radius vector starting from the center and going to the point at which the particle is, because this is the position vector r, r is the position vector. Okay, so this starts from the origin and goes to the point at which the point is located. Okay, so at any point p would be there and r will tell you the position of the particle. So r is the position vector. Okay, now we will see further things. Now the external torque will be in the direction of motion, because this external torque will produce angular velocity, means the particle will execute an angular motion having a velocity of omega. So omega is the angular velocity executed by the particle in the angular motion. Okay, and that angular motion is caused by the torque applied. Okay, so T is the torque applied or the external torque. Okay, and both have the same direction, because if you apply the torque in any direction, means if you are applying the torque in one direction, then omega will also be in the same direction. So in the previous figure we have seen that omega has a sign of anti-clockwise. Okay, so torque will also have the direction of anti-clockwise. Okay, so torque external is in the direction of omega. Okay, I am talking about the previous figure. In the previous figure we have seen that omega was in the anti-clockwise, so T external was also anti-clockwise, and this we are talking about the motion that is happening, not the restoring one. We are not talking about the restoring one, we are just talking about the motion that is happening. So external torque produces angular velocity omega that is seen by the person from the frame of reference. Okay, now this torsion or torque induces force. Okay, or this force induces torque, but the requirement is that this force should be at a distance of r from the axis of rotation or revolution or oscillation. Okay, here we are dealing with rotation, okay, or revolution. Okay, not oscillation. Oscillation we are dealing with simple harmonic motion, but you know that circular motion is nothing but just a part of simple harmonic motion. That's why oscillation is also violated. Okay, so oscillation happens in vibration and simple harmonic motion, but I'm just talking about the T and F here. That's why this torque will give you F when this F is acting at a distance R from the axis of rotation. Okay, and similarly this F will give torque if applied from a distance R. Okay, now torque gives omega and alpha. Okay, because torque is equal to I into alpha. Okay, so and F gives AT and V, means tangential velocity and tangential acceleration. This F will give AT only, so F will give AT and T will give alpha. Okay, so T will give alpha and F will give AT. Okay, means torque will produce angular acceleration, and force means linear force will produces linear acceleration. Okay, Now you can get, if you are given alpha, you can have at, and if you are given v, you can have omega, or if you are given omega, then you can find v. Okay, so omega is equal to means v is equal to omega into r, and at is equal to alpha into r. Okay, now we will also see that this alpha into r and omega into r are cross product. Okay, so that we will see. Now when alpha is constant, okay, the motion is in inertial frame and viewed from an inertial frame of reference. Means the motion is happening in an inertial frame of reference and also viewed from the inertial frame of reference. Okay, because alpha is equal to constant, means the particle is not having any acceleration. Okay, the particle is not accelerating, the alpha is equal to constant. So the motion is in inertial frame and viewed from an inertial frame of reference. If not, then apply pseudo force or pseudo torque, means opposite to the motion of the frame of reference. So if the some force or torque is acting at the, whether in the motion, in the, because not in the motion, means the in the frame of reference from which you are watching the motion. Okay, so you have to apply the pseudo force or pseudo torque to bring that frame of reference from which you are watching the motion into the inertial frame of reference. Okay, to make that frame of reference into inertial one, you have to apply pseudo force or pseudo torque. Okay, if that inertial frame of reference is under a force of, means under a application of any external force or external torque, then to make that in a frame of reference as an inertial one, you have to apply pseudo force. Okay, now a and alpha are the linear and angular acceleration of the non-inertial frame of reference. So this a and alpha are the linear and angular acceleration of the non-inertial frame of reference. Okay, so this minus m into a and minus m into alpha are the pseudo forces, where a and alpha are the linear and angular acceleration respectively of the non-inertial frame of reference. Now alpha is equal to constant, so theta is equal to omega I plus half alpha t square. Okay, or omega f is equal to omega I plus alpha t, or not or, means these are three equations. Okay, so this is theta, this is omega f, and this is relation between theta and omega f and omega I. Okay, so omega f into whole square minus omega I into whole square is equal to 2 alpha into theta. Okay, where omega I is the initial angular velocity. Okay, so initial angular velocity is the angular velocity at the initial point. Okay, means the point at which the time was equal to 0, means the initial time. Okay, so omega I is the initial angular velocity, or angular velocity at time is equal to 0, and omega f is the angular velocity at time t. Okay, means after a time interval of t, means the motion is happening and you are want to find the omega at a particular time when time t has been elapsed. Okay, similarly, when a is equal to constant, expression for v, u, a and s can be found. Okay, so respect means you replace theta by s, replace alpha by a, replace omega f by v and omega I by u. Okay, and then you can write the expression for v, u, a, s respectively. As in case of linear motion, you have done, this is the expression for angular motion, and you can also find the expression for linear motion also by doing the replacement. Along with linear distance, delta s is equal to pp dash. Okay, means the distance traveled by the particle in time delta t. which is equal to R into delta theta. Now this is the cross product that we will see. So the linear distance delta s is equal to pp dash, means the distance traveled by the particle in the duration of delta t. Okay, sir. So delta t is the time duration. Now this linear distance delta s is equal to r into delta theta. Now this is distance. Now if you are talking about displacement, okay, so displacement is a vector. Okay, so then vector delta s is equal to cross product of position vector and angular displacement. So r into delta theta. Now delta theta is equal to omega into delta t. So r into cross product of r into omega into delta t. Now this r cross omega, okay, this is the cross product, means position vector r or the radial vector r into omega, which is the angular velocity. So cross product of r into omega will give you v, which is the linear velocity or tangential velocity v, okay, which is the cross product of r into omega. Now this will be give you v, and this is delta t. Okay, so delta s is equal to v into delta t, okay, where v is the linear or tangential speed of the particle, okay, as a magnitude one, because the magnitude of the velocity is known as a speed. Okay, so v is the linear or tangential speed of the particle. Now tangential acceleration, at is equal to dv by dt, is equal to cross product of r into alpha. So alpha is the angular acceleration, r is the position vector. Now this tangential acceleration is not the net acceleration, okay, this is not the net acceleration. This tangential acceleration we are seeing is equal to dv by dt. This is not the net acceleration in circular motion, because the net acceleration is a vector sum of tangential and radial acceleration. Okay, that we will see. Now the radial and tangential acceleration we talked about. So this radial and tangential acceleration will be represented in terms of radial and tangential unit vector. Okay, so this radial vector is represented by I cos theta plus J sin theta, means I is in that x direction and J is in the y direction. Okay, and the tangential unit vector ET is equal to minus of I sin theta plus J sin theta. Now you can see here, this is just the differentiation. Okay, you differentiate cos theta, you will get minus sin theta. You differentiate sin theta, you will get cos theta. Means if you remember this ER value, then you don't need to remember this ET. Okay, you just remember ER, means ER is equal to I cos theta into J sin theta, and you can have this ET. Okay, just differentiate this and you will get this, means minus of I sin theta plus J cos theta. Okay, so position vector of the particle at any time t is represented by r. Now r is equal to r into cos theta I plus sin theta J, which is equal to r into er. So er is the radial unit vector. Acceleration of the particle at any time t, so represented by a, is equal to dv by dt minus omega square r into er plus r dw d omega by dt into et. Okay, so this is the net acceleration we were talking about. So minus of omega square into r into er plus dv by dt into et. Now we have seen these two acceleration in the means in the circular motion there will be two accelerations. Okay, one will be the tangential one and one will be the radial one. Okay, now we have understand this. Now we will see uniform circular motion. Okay, so uniform circular motion means velocity is constant, means the particle is doing its motion at a constant velocity. Okay, now this in this uniform circular motion the velocity is constant, this is velocity. Okay, now the velocity is such a way that the magnitude is constant but only direction is changing. Okay, so uniform circular motion tangential acceleration is equal to zero, means dv by dt is equal to zero, means v is equal to constant, means velocity of the particle is equal to constant and acceleration of the particle at any time t is only the radial one. Okay, means tangential part is equal to zero, so the acceleration of the particle at any time is only the radial one. Okay, now this radial one is represented by minus of omega square r into er. Okay, this is the minus one. Okay, means this is acting towards the center, this is minus one, this is radius, radial vector. Now do you know that radial vector is from the center outwards, from the center outwards, so when you put the minus sign it means it is acting inwards. Okay, so this AR value is towards the center acting radially and this is known as centripetal acceleration. Okay, so centripetal acceleration is towards the center. Okay, now the magnitude of this acceleration is equal to omega square into r, which is also represented by v square by r, because v is nothing but omega into r, so you get this expression. So v is the tangential speed and the velocity is tangential velocity, which is constant in magnitude but changing in direction. So this is the uniform circular motion. Now non-uniform circular motion. Okay, now still it's a circular motion only, that's why the path traced by the particle is a circular one. Okay, the only difference from the uniform circular motion is that in the previous case in the uniform circular motion the velocity was constant, but in non-uniform circular motion the velocity is not constant, so the differentiation of velocity with respect to time is also not equal to zero. Now in this case the acceleration has both tangential and radial components. In uniform circular motion we didn't have this tangential part, but the non-uniform circular motion will have both the tangential and the radial components. Okay, so acceleration is equal to minus of omega square r is equal to minus of v square r, which is the centripetal acceleration. Okay, means towards the center, and center is also known as origin, mean position or equilibrium position. Why? Because the net force acting at the center, acting at the origin, or acting at the mean position, or acting at the equilibrium position is equal to zero. And when force is equal to zero, means acceleration is equal to zero, because force is nothing but mass into acceleration. So if force, net force is equal to zero, means net acceleration is also zero, which is happening at the center in case of circular motion. So this is the radial acceleration and this is the tangential acceleration. So tangential acceleration is equal to dv by dt and v is the linear velocity or tangential velocity. So this is tangential acceleration. When you will differentiate a tangential velocity, then you will get tangential acceleration. Okay, now the resultant acceleration or the acceleration of the particle at any time t. Okay, now you know that these are the two vectors. Okay, and these two vectors are perpendicular to each other. Okay, both this radial and tangential, both are perpendicular to each other, that's why the resultant is just a square of this, means AR square plus AT square. Why? Because this both AT and AR are perpendicular to each other. That's why the resultant acceleration or the acceleration of the particle at any time t is equal to under root of ar square plus at square. So ar is the radial acceleration and at is the tangential acceleration or linear acceleration. Okay. Now ar is equal to v square by r, so whole square, and at is equal to dv by dt, that's why whole square. Now tan alpha is equal to dv by dt by v square by r. Okay, means tangential acceleration by radial acceleration. Now we will see what is alpha. Okay. Now in this figure you will understand everything. Okay. So in this figure you can see the direction of tangential acceleration, the direction of tangential velocity or the linear velocity. Okay, this is the net acceleration, a is the net acceleration, ar is the centripetal acceleration. So centripetal is towards the center. In any question if you are asked centrifugal, means centrifugal means away from the center. Okay, so this is represented by this is also means the magnitude is same, both are the same thing, omega square r only, but only difference is the direction. Okay, so in the centripetal the direction is towards the center, and in case of centrifugal the direction is away from the center. Okay, both have the same magnitude, omega square into r only. Okay, now the dynamics of circular motion means the forces associated in the uniform circular motion. Okay, so uniform circular motion, you know that tangential acceleration is equal to zero. So now we just saying that what are the dynamics of the circular motion, means the forces associated with a uniform circular motion. So you know that this is the uniform circular motion, means tangential acceleration is equal to zero, means tangential force is not there, only the radial force will be there, whether it's a centrifugal force or a centripetal force. Okay, whatever it is, that will be the only force acting. Okay, now this motion is seen from the inertial frame of reference to an inertial frame of reference, okay, in which the motion is happening. Okay, you know pseudo forces, because if the frame of reference is not the inertial one, you can make it to an inertial one by applying a pseudo force. Okay, that has been discussed before also in the same video. So dynamics of uniform circular motion means the forces associated in a uniform circular motion is F is equal to mv square by r, which is the centripetal or centrifugal force, whether whatever it is. Okay. So when only centripetal force is acting, the particle will execute uniform circular motion. So this is the omega happening, because this is the direction you must know, because the v is decided by the omega and r only. Okay. So this is angular displacement theta, and this is the linear distance delta s. In terms of linear, if you are given the linear distance, then this is delta s, displacement, not distance. Okay, so this is delta s displacement, which is the linear displacement, and this is the theta, which is the angular displacement. Okay, now we have understood circular motion completely. Now we know uniform circular motion, now we know non-uniform circular motion. So now we will see application, because without application there is no engineering, no science. Okay, science is there, but engineering is all about application. Okay, so application must be there if you are an engineer. Okay, so this is the application of circular motion. Okay, the fundamentals that we have studied will have a practical application, and this particular application is seen in circular turnings by providing banking in roads. Okay, so this is the circular path. Okay, this is the circular, means this dotted line, this dotted line is the circular path in which the particle or the any vehicle of mass m is moving. So this is going clockwise. Okay, so this is omega. So this is Fs is the friction force given by the road. Okay, so Fs is the friction given by the road. Mvr square is the centrifugal force acting on the vehicle by while moving on this circular road. Okay, the centrifugal force will try to push the vehicle away from the, means it will try to push the radially. Okay, so centrifugal force wants to push outside. Okay, now this is the linear velocity v and this is the angular velocity omega. This is the position vector or the radial position of the vehicle in terms of in with respect to the center. Okay, so this is the center. Now if you see isometrically, okay, so this is the circular path. Okay, now in the circular path means the circular road, okay, or the turning. Okay, so this is the banking provided, means the slope has been provided, means the inclination has been provided radially. Okay, the inclination is increasing radially. This is the theta provided, which is known as banking of roads. Okay, so what does this theta do? So by giving an inclination theta, now this will be the normal reaction, means this will be the mg. Okay, so mg is acting downwards, this is the downwards, and this n is the normal reaction from the road. Okay, so this is the normal reaction from the road. Okay, so normal reaction always perpendicular to the surface, so this is perpendicular to the road. Now this have two components, n sin theta and n cos theta. Now this n cos theta will compensate for the weight of the body, means weight of the vehicle mg, and this n sin theta will try to compensate for the centrifugal force. Okay, means whatever the centrifugal force was acting, the centrifugal force wants to push the vehicle away from the, means wants to move the vehicle away from the circular path. Okay, means wants to keep it out. So this n sin theta will try to keep the body intact. Okay, means in the circular motion, this n sin theta will act opposite to this mv square r. Okay, now if the friction is not given, because that we will see that you cannot always rely on the friction, that's why bankings are provided. Okay, means inclinations are given. Okay, so this mv square r will be compensated by n sin theta. Okay, because you cannot always rely on the friction. Friction is there, but you cannot rely on it. Okay, so n cos theta is equal to mg. Okay, that you can see that n cos theta is equal to mg. N sin theta is equal to mb square r. Okay, so n sin theta is acting inside and mb square r is acting outside. Okay, so n sin theta is equal to mb square by r, which is the centrifugal force, and centrifugal force act outwards. Okay, centripetal act inwards and centrifugal force act outwards. Okay, So this n sin theta is equal to mv square r. Okay, means centrifugal force is equal to the centripetal force given by the normal reaction. Okay, now from these two expression, n cos theta is equal to mg and n sin theta is equal to mv square by r, you will get tan theta is equal to v square by rg. So theta depends upon v and r, where v is the linear velocity of the vehicle or linear speed of the vehicle, and r is the radius of curvature or the radius of the circular path. Okay, now theta is the inclination of the road or banking. Now about the figure. Now this figure is of about a vehicle of mass m moving at a speed v, making a turn on a circular path of radius r. So this is the vehicle represented by a point mass. Okay. It's a point body having a mass m. Okay. Now forces acting on the vehicle or the car, if you are assuming the vehicle as a car, then the forces acting on that car is equal to weight mg, which is acting downwards. So this is mg acting downwards. The normal reaction from the ground upwards, so this n is the normal reaction from the ground. The ground is the road one, so this is the normal force. And the third one is the friction force fs acting towards the center, and this is the static friction. Not the kinematic friction, but the static friction acting towards the center. Okay, so this is Fs acting towards the center. Okay. Now that we said that Fs cannot be relied upon, so banking are provided. Okay, because you cannot expect that Fs will give you the required centripetal acceleration, that's why bankings are provided. So tires try to skid outwards, and because of the centrifugal force, okay, so because of the centrifugal force, the tires try to skid outwards. Okay, and the friction force opposes this, okay, by acting inwards to the center. So mv square r is equal to fs is equal to mu s into n. So mu s is the coefficient of a static friction, mv square is equal to centrifugal force on the vehicle. Okay, banking we have seen. Because in banking, because in terms of only theta, this mv square r will be compensated by n sin theta. But we are not considering here banking, we are just considering here the friction. Okay, so if the only we have not provided any banking and we are just relying on the friction, then this friction will give you the required centripetal force. Okay, so mv square r, which is the centrifugal force on the vehicle, will be compensated by the friction given by the road. Okay, so Fs is equal to mu s into n. So mu s is the coefficient of a static friction. For a safe turn, this Fs should be greater than the centrifugal force. Okay, so centripetal acceleration should be more than the centrifugal means the centripetal force or the centripetal acceleration also. So centripetal force should be greater than the centrifugal force, and then only the safe turn can be made. Okay, and this centripetal acceleration is given by the friction of the road. Okay, so Fs is greater than equal to mv square by r, or mu s is equal is greater than equal to v square by r. Okay, it should be g here also. Okay, r into g. Okay, g has been left out. Okay, write it here, g also. G is the gravity. Okay, g. Okay, g has been missed here. V square by rg. Okay. Okay, change it and make it rg here. Okay, not just v square by r, it should be v square by r into g. So g is the gravity, 9.81 meter per second square. So v square by rg. okay, so mu s should be greater than equal to b square by r into g. So g is the 9.81 meter per second square, which is the gravity. Now that we have been saying that friction may not be reliable always, okay, if the speed is high and the turns are sharp, you cannot rely on the frictions, okay. That's why bankings are provided and inclination are given. Or now this inclination is increasing radially, okay. Now change it to just g, okay, v square by rg, okay, because this is mu s into n, fs is mu s into n, and n is, you know, this is the normal force, this is the weight, and weight is equal to m into g. That's why g will also come. So change this formula, okay. So whatever the normal force is there, put it here, mu into n, this would be greater than mb square by r. That's why mu s into n, and replace this m, and you will get v square by rg. Whatever the normal force, according to that normal force, you will get the expression, okay. If this n is something else, means mg sin theta, mg cos theta, whatever it is, then you have to put accordingly. Now if you are only having n is equal to mg, then this expression will come, mu s is greater than equal to v square by rg, okay. So that's all for the circular motion. Thank you.